video, we're going to look at further modifications to the gas turbines. Previously, we've looked at the regenerative gas turbines, but with those kinds of modifications, the network that is developed across the entire cycle did not change. Only Q dot N, the heat content that was added into the cycle, was reduced. Now we're going to look at a modification with it, which is called reheating. And with this kind of modification, we are going to increase the net work developed across the turbine stages, or across the turbine stage expansion. So let's just look at the schematic first. The change that you would notice is that instead of just a single stage turbine, we've got a two-stage turbine now. And instead of having just a single combustion chamber, we've got a reheat combustion chamber as well. So that means we are adding heat content twice instead of just once as we did previously. Now the important thing is that the temperature of the gaseous combustion products that is added into the combustion chamber has to be limited because of certain metallurgical reasons. So the only way that we can control the temperature is by providing air in excess amount to burn the fuel in the combustion chamber. And because of that, as a consequence, the gas that is going to exit the combustion chamber is going to contain sufficient air to support combustion of additional fuel. And this is actually done by the addition of the reheat combustion chamber between the two turbine stages. So if you look at the TS diagram for this schematic, what's going to happen is that when we get to state three here, which is the turbine inlet, the gas is going to expand within this first stage turbine, and at the exit of the turbine, it's going to enter the reheat combustion chamber because it's still going to be having excess amount of air, and then this can basically go into the combustion chamber at here, get mixed in with more fuel, get heated up, and come to point B at the reheat combustion exit, or the turbine inlet at stage two. And then we allow the gas to expand within the turbine stage two from state B to state four. So the important question to ask here is that, does this really benefit us having two turbine stages here? And would the work done across these two turbine stages be greater than if we were, if we had, let's say, a single expansion from state three to state four dash? So is work done greater from state three to state four dash, this vertical line, or is work done greater from state three until state four through a two-stage turbine? The answer to that is that by having two turbine stages, what's going to happen is that, so these are lines of constant pressure, right? This is a constant pressure line, and this is a constant pressure line as well. So as the entropy increases, these constant pressure lines start to diverge more and more. So what we've essentially done is that we've expanded through the first stage of the turbine, and then when we moved it on to state B, so as we move in this direction, these constant pressure lines are diverging. That means the distances are basically becoming larger. So the distance between these two lines here would be larger than the distance between these two lines, say, here. And the distance between the two lines here would be larger than the distance between two lines here. So if we're letting the gas expand over here at this point, or at this subsection from three to four dash, then these two lines are going to be closer to each other. Whereas if we've let the gas expand from 3 to A, first, and then from B to 4, then this B to 4 distance has increased, and that means that the work done across the two turbine stages would be greater as compared to the work done across only one turbine stage. However, we also need to see that although the work done has increased, so has the heat content that has been added in, because now the heat content is being added in twice. But at the same time, we've got this turbine exhaust that is now at a higher temperature. So if we used a regenerator in here as well, then that would make a lot of sense, because now we've got this turbine exhaust which is at a higher temperature than it would have been if we were at 0.4 dash, and that allows for the regenerator to preheat this incoming air into the compressor to a higher degree. So let's just go ahead and look at this example or the question that includes not only the reheating but the regeneration as well. We're looking at a modification of a previous cycle that we've looked at in a previous video. We've got reheat and regeneration included. So what we're going to essentially do is we're going to find out the enthalpies at all the states. So we find out the enthalpy at state 1, the enthalpy at state 2, the enthalpy at state 3 as well. And then from the question, we're given that after reheating, we're reheating it to 1400 kelvins, and the first turbine inlet stage is at 1400 kelvins as well. So basically, H3 is going to be equal to H at state B. To find out the enthalpy at state A, we've got the pressure ratios given to us, we've got the pressure given at state 3, we've got the pressure given at state A, so we can find out the pressure ratio PA by P3, and using that we can find out the relative pressure at A, PRA, which is going to be equal to PR at 3 multiplied by the pressure ratio PA by P3, and using that we can find out the enthalpy at state A, and just like that we can also find out the enthalpy at state 4 by finding out the relative pressure at 4PR4, and using that we can find out the enthalpy at state 4. And because the regenerative effectiveness is given to us as 80%, so one thing to note here is that actually we had an effectiveness given to us at 100% here. That's why you see the point X here, which is in conjunction with 0.4, but because I've changed the value to 80% now, then that means that this point is going to be lower than the 0.4. So X is going to be somewhere here. So then using the regenerator effectiveness, you could find out the value for enthalpy at X. And because we have all the enthalpies now, so then we can go ahead and find out the thermal efficiency for this cycle with reheating and regeneration. So just to review, the strategy for solving this kind of question should be that you need to find out the enthalpies at all the states. The enthalpies at state 1, 2, and 3 are easier to compute, so we go ahead and compute those first. Then we find out the enthalpy at state B in this specific question, because we've got temperature, the reheat temperature, which is equal to the first turbine stage temperature. So that's why HB is going to be equal to H3. Then we go ahead and use the relative pressure ratio and find out PR at state A. Using that and combining it with data table A22, we can find out the enthalpy at state A. Then we go ahead and find out the relative pressure at 4. And using that in coordination with table A22, in Shapiro's book, we go ahead and find out the enthalpy at state 4. And finally, we find out the enthalpy at state X, which is the regenerator exit, because we've got the effectiveness given to us. So using that relation, we can find out the enthalpy at X. And then last of all, we can find out the thermal efficiency
in which the net work done is going to be equal to your first turbine stage, which is H3 minus HA, plus your second turbine stage, which is HB minus H4, minus the compressor work, which is H2 minus H1, divided by the heat content that is added, which is done twice here, once in the combustion chamber, the second in the reheat combustion chamber. So divided by H3 minus HX plus HB minus HA, because these are the two processes in which you are adding Q dot N into the system. So that's how you're going to find out the thermal efficiency for this kind of cycle, this kind of Brayton cycle with reheat and regeneration. So now that we've looked at reheating, which takes place with the turbine stages, we can try and find out other ways through which we can increase our efficiency. And one of the ways to do that is to look at this process 1 to 2, and see if we can do something here. And usually the way that it is done is that we use an intercooler, which is a heat exchanger in itself, and we basically devolve our compression into different stages. So we've got multi-stage compression taking place with an intercooler in between. And in this way, what happens is that the temperature at 2 is reduced, first of all. And because of this, the work that is being provided into the compressor, that is reduced as well. Because if you make a comparison here between, say, process 1 to 2 dash, from process 1 to 2 dash on this TS diagram, compared to process 1 to C and D to 2, the work input that you're providing for process 1 to 2 dash is higher as compared to the work input that you're providing to the compressor when the compression takes place in stages 1 to C and D to 2, because these constant pressure lines are coming closer as we move to the left on this TS diagram. And because they're coming closer, so that means they require less amount of work. Other than that, you've got process 1 to C, which is going to be an isentropic compression, and you've got process C to D, where you've got constant pressure cooling taking place in the intercooler, and then process D to 2, which is again an isentropic compression process until you reach state 2. Another thing to realize is that intercooling, or using intercooling by itself, may not be beneficial. Instead, you use intercooling along with regeneration as well, because the point is that if you were using intercooling by itself, then the temperature is, if you see the temperature now after intercooling, it's here. It's a lower temperature. Without intercooling, your temperature is around here. So the amount of fuel now that you have to provide in the combustion chamber would be a lot more if you were not using a regenerator here, right? So the only way that intercooling makes sense is if you use regeneration as well, because then it would be beneficial, because now you have a lower temperature at the combustion inlet, and this lower temperature at the compressor exit is going to enhance your potential for regeneration. So you use intercooling with regeneration, and then you're going to have a good amount of increase in the thermal efficiency as well. Other than this, if you've got larger compressors, then there's going to be several stages of compression taking place with intercooling, so you would have more compressor stages than just two stages. So if we were to use intercooling and reheating together along with regeneration, this is one of the arrangements that is possible. So you've got two compressor stages here with intercooling, and then you've got two turbine stages here with reheat taking place in combustion chamber two here, and you've got a regenerator as well, and the TS diagram here is shown as well. So I'm going to leave you with this problem here now to try, so you can try and do it yourself and get a good idea about how you can attempt these kind of questions.